Several years ago, a reviewer described Robert J. Lifton as indefatigable, and I would suggest that this description works better than many descriptions applied by many reviewers to many authors. Professor Lifton received his MD at New York Medical College in 1948 at the age of 22. He has for many years been associated with John Jay College of the City University of New York, where he's now Distinguished Professor of Psychology and Psychiatry. And he has also served as a visiting professor or researcher at many of the world's finest universities, including Harvard, Yale, Cornell, and Tokyo. The breadth of his interests is well reflected in his numerous and almost innumerable memberships: a fellow of the American Psychiatric Association, a member of the Association for Asian Studies, of the American Anthropological Association, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, a member of the Group for the Study of Psychohistorical Process, a coordinator indeed for that group. And we can see this breadth also reflected in the, again, innumerable honors that he's received. One can cite really only a few of them, otherwise this would become a talk in and of itself. The Mount Airy Foundation Gold Medal for Excellence in Psychiatry, a National Book Award in the Sciences in 1969, the Los Angeles Times Book Award for History in 1987, and so it goes. Professor Lifton's more than 20 books likewise reflect this extraordinary energy and an extraordinary range of interests. To mention just a few of the best known, and again to suggest something of the range, his 1968 work, Death and Life, Survivors of Hiroshima. His book, History and Human Survival, in 1970. Then it was Home from the War, Vietnam Veterans, Neither Victims Nor Executioners, in 1973. Recently he published The Protean Self, Human Resilience in an Age of Fragmentation. And reflecting his ongoing interests in Asian and particularly Japanese culture and society, he is currently working on a book on Om Shinrikyo, the group often described as a doomsday cult, the one often, well, blamed in any case for the gassings on the Tokyo subway, which some of you recall took place last March. But while there's range, there's also interconnectedness in his work, in his associations, his honors, and his writings. For one thing, we consistently see a strong social conscience at work. And we can remember that Professor Lifton is, among other things, a member of the Physicians for Social Responsibility and the Medical Committee for Human Rights. One of his early honors was a public service award from the New York Society for Clinical Psychologists. In 1984, he received the Gandhi Peace Award. For more than 20 years, he has published extensively on the nuclear threat, sometimes in terms of its historical dimension at Hiroshima, sometimes looking to future dangers. Another theme that connects much of his work is an interest in individuals and groups that have been placed in extreme situations, facing death or coming to grips with a past experience in which they had faced death. And this brings us to his work on the Holocaust. And what of this work? Here we have two main works. The Nazi Doctors, Medical Killing and the Psychology of Genocide, published in 1986. And the second work, which he has co-authored, The Genocidal Mentality, Nazi Holocaust, and Nuclear Threat. In both works, there is, of course, the theme of death, but primarily from the vantage point of the executioners, the questions focusing on them, the executioners, the perpetrators. For years, the popular image or model of the perpetrators portrayed people of almost a different species, men of violence, sadistic, killing Jews and other victims and loving it. In the early 1960s, by contrast, Hannah Arendt produced a very different model, that of the bureaucrat who oversaw the killing process without pulling the trigger, and she coined the phrase, the banality of evil, to account for him. Professor Lifton has focused on still a third model, the Nazi doctor, the individual seemingly bound by ethics to protect life, and yet drawn ultimately to destroy it. How people, particularly well-educated professionals, could be co-opted to a campaign of mass murder is the subject of Professor Lifton's talk tonight. This said, on behalf of OSU and the Holocaust Memorial Program, I'm very pleased to welcome Robert J. Lifton to speak to us on Genocidal Mentality, the Nazi Doctors, and the Holocaust.
Thanks very much, Professor Kaufman. I really appreciate that generous and warm introduction. But there is a danger in that kind of introduction, and namely, that one may believe it. In addition to some of the things that Professor Kopperman very kindly described, I also am an amateur bird cartoonist, maybe not even an amateur. I've published two little books of bird cartoons, and in these bird cartoons I can say certain things without having any artistic talent. I can say certain things a little bit more directly than in my other works, and the one I want to mention tonight seems appropriate for this moment. I like to consider it my existential classic. In this particular bird cartoon, a young, enthusiastic bird looks up and says, "All of a sudden, I had this wonderful feeling, I am me." And an older, more skeptical, more jaundiced bird looks down and says, "You are wrong." On that note, I begin. I've been in Corvallis only a couple of days. I've been made to feel very much at home here, and I'm impressed and moved by the energy and dedication of the group which is responsible for the Holocaust Commemorative Week, the Holocaust Memorial Week that is being so finely arranged here. I'm especially grateful to Professor Kopperman, who has been thoughtful and considerate and available in the arrangements that we've made together. And I've been warmly treated, wined and dined, and made to feel very comfortable here. It's going to be hard to leave. This is Holocaust Memorial Week. To memorialize is to re-witness. When I did my work on Nazi genocide and also on Hiroshima and some of the other things that you heard mentioned, I saw myself as a psychiatrist doing scientific work, and I still do. But I've come to realize over the years that I was also attempting to perform a kind of witness. A witness must take in an event, must allow its truths to enter into his or her imagination, and then reconstruct that event, tell the tale. That's what a witness does. To memorialize is to re-witness, to return to that event. Now, the primary witnesses of an event like the Holocaust are, of course, the survivors. They are the key to our knowledge about what actually happened. They were thrust into the role by the very force of the event. Those of us who study the Holocaust become what might be called secondary witnesses, or if we do it from the standpoint of some profession, we become witnessing professionals. And our work has some importance as well, because we struggle to bring to bear our own intellectual and moral tradition to this recreation of these events. And we can make a contribution in that way. But in doing so, we're wise to remain in dialogue with actual survivors who are the source of that knowledge. That dialogue is crucial, especially as survivors become an aging population and they themselves express their worry about who will tell the tale after they are gone. The tale must be told again and again over various generations, and one does that always from the standpoint of the present. We know that we cannot be adequate witnesses to an event of this dimension. We can't help, we don't have the imaginative power to encompass it all. But with that limitation, we must take on the obligation to be retrospective witnesses and to be as true to the event as we can. In that sense, we are recreating the event from the present, because all of us are in our own historical moment, and we ourselves involved in this relentless forward movement of history. That's important, because the point here is that memorialization and the witness we make through memorialization is an act on behalf of the future, not the past. However modest our efforts, what they have to do with is an assertion of life continuity, that is, of the broad human future. The practice of genocide by anyone, anywhere, is a threat to the entire human future. The word was coined by Raphael Lemkin, who was an international lawyer and himself a survivor from Europe of the Holocaust. He lost more than 50 family members in the Holocaust. He was determined in creating the term genocide to create a concept that would apply universally to anyone, any group that attempted mass killing or the destruction of a what was called a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group. It was meant to universalize the crime. He spoke of it as an old practice in its modern development. He knew that by naming it would be the beginning of a commitment to combating it. And that was his purpose. Indeed, my co-author Eric Marks and I dedicated our book, The Genocidal Mentality, to his memory, because he was a heroic figure who fought all of his life to create the concept, to have it accepted as it finally was, as a convention by the United Nations, and then very belatedly signed on by the United States as well. In my own work, I've had some kind of concern with a number of experiences of genocide and mass killing. Of course, the Nazi doctors, which I'm going to be talking about more this evening, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, which are categorized as genocide by Leo Cooper, the leading authority on the subject, who died just a year or two ago, so-called ethnic cleansing in Bosnia, which I've been involved in and with other people in trying to create the climate for intervention, with not too much success. In the Turkish genocide of Armenians, the most hidden of all genocides in the first of our century, which took place mostly in 1915, in which the Turks killed up to 1.5 million Armenians, mostly with guns or clubs. That was crucial in many ways. It led to the famous statement by Hitler when briefing his SS generals very early in the very beginnings of the genocide, first involving Poles and then Jews, in which Hitler said to them, "Whoever nowadays thinks about the extermination of the Armenians," in other words, Genocide is contagious, and if it's not stopped, it spreads. And most recently, as Professor Kopman mentioned, I've been studying Aum Shinrikyo, the Japanese extremist cult which literally sought to commit genocide on the entire world. It had a scheme, however grandiose, but had some of the weapons to back it up for literally bringing about Armageddon in a kind of total genocide. That made me think about a lot of things, but it made me realize that much of genocide has a mystical component, a deeply non-rational vision that the world will be perfected or purified or improved by destroying a particular people. What then is a genocidal mentality? Well, genocidal mentality is, putting it most simply, support for or acquiescence in genocide as I've defined it or as Raphael Lemkin defined it. It's participation in actions or support for actions or policies which, if carried out, would lead to genocide. The best, most important model we have is that of the Nazis and Nazi genocide. And let me take you through a model in terms of historical and psychological sequence, because we learn this from the Nazis, but it applies to all the other genocides I mentioned, and indeed to the terrible genocides we see literally taking place before our eyes in Bosnia and in Rwanda. The sequence goes like this. There is first what is experienced as an extreme historical trauma, a kind of sickness unto death, a near destruction of one's people as one experiences it. And this had to do in the German case with the defeat in the First World War, following upon a long and painful sequence of modernization and unification for which the war was supposed to be a cure, but instead it was an ignominious defeat. Then along came post-World War I, a series of revitalizing ideologies, ideologies that promised to make Germany strong again, of which Hitler's and the Nazis turned out to be the strongest or the most compelling for Germans. At some point, that revitalizing ideology, and I mean this to be a general model, not just for the Germans or the Nazis, the revitalizing ideology becomes genocidal. You can recognize that beginning switch when the ideology requires victims, and the notion is that some group must be destroyed in order to carry through that noble revitalization. You must always keep in mind that the killing of large numbers of people requires a claim to virtue. In any case, the ideology becomes genocidal, and genocidal institutions are built, like Auschwitz. Professionals are central to the process, intellectuals and professionals. They provide the rationale for the genocide, much of the ideology, also its organization and its technology, and they often take the lead in carrying through the genocide, as was the case of the Nazis. And then you get the function of professional killers who are cultivated or trained in the ranks to be killers, and killing professionals who play the role that I just mentioned. And that has to be noted. There is a crossing of a genocidal threshold in this sequence, beyond which there's no turning back. And it develops, the process that is, develops a kind of bureaucratic momentum. And in the case of the Nazis, the decision for the genocide was apparently made in early 1941, it is thought, with lots of back and forth influence from some of the middle echelons trying to figure out what the Führer wanted, but influencing the eventual outcome with their cruel behavior, making some of the genocide a fait accompli even before Hitler's order. Much of that, of course, grounded in the genocidal ideology, which Hitler was the central figure in evolving. Now, depicting the sequence in this way provides a model that each of the other genocides in some way parallels. And depicting it is a way, a statement of understanding this kind of process in order to struggle to prevent it. In this work, then, we study genocide to prevent its recurrence. One can say, metaphorically, we look into the abyss in order to be able to see beyond it. We must look into the abyss to know what endangers us in our time, otherwise we're ostriches. But on the other hand, we must avoid fixating ourselves on the abyss. We must see beyond it in order to improve our world or protect our world from this kind of recurrence. Otherwise, we're immobilized or all too fascinated by that abyss. When I did my study of Nazi doctors, mostly in the late 70s and early 80s, I also interviewed many survivors in different countries in various parts of the world. I want to mention a phrase that came from one of these interviews because it epitomizes much that I have to say. I was interviewing an Israeli dentist in Haifa, which is a very beautiful city overlooking the harbor, and he had a very nice home at the top of the heights overlooking the harbor, and we sat in a comfortable sitting room as he told me his story, a very painful one, because he had managed to survive 3 years in Auschwitz, which was a miracle in itself, particularly for a Jew. At the end of the interview, which was painful for him and very valuable for me, he sighed deeply and said to me, "This world is not this world. This world is not this world." What he meant was that whatever the comfort in one's immediate surroundings, and they were very comfortable surroundings, if you've known Auschwitz, you know that there's menace that lies beneath. Genocide, the mass killing of large numbers of human beings, is the menace of which he was, to which he was referring. And of course, it's a particular menace when those who are charged with being healers in a society instead join the ranks of the killers. And in that sense, the physician's role in genocide, which was very central, as I'll make clear, was in some ways the last to be uncovered. It's only in recent years that fuller information about all that was done in the reversal of healing and killing has been brought out, partly because it's possibly the most shameful of all the shameful episodes in Nazi genocide, because these were people who took an oath to be healers. Now, it isn't only Nazi doctors who were in one way or another corrupted and became involved in dubious behavior. One only need think of the Soviet psychiatrists who incarcerated heretics put them into mental hospitals as a means of dealing with heretics, working hand in glove with the Soviet government, or doctors who have been involved in torture, as in Chile, in the actual torture, and often doctors are involved to examine people to see whether they're well enough subjected to torture, as strange as that sounds. But in Chile, they actually were involved in the torture itself. And then in South Africa, where during the notorious times of apartheid, falsification of death certificates, and our own CIA enlisting doctors and psychologists in the United States and Canada in various experiments in mind control, for which there have been a number of legal cases, one of which I've been involved in. And then, of course, the People's Temple cult, in which in Guyana almost 1,000 people died through suicide or murder, and the person who mixed the potion, which was a mixture of cyanide and Kool-Aid, as befits the times, perhaps, the late 1970s, was, of course, an idealistic young physician and member of the cult. So that doctors are enlisted or give themselves willingly, join in these expressions of genocide, or at least of killing and harming fellow human beings, partly because we physicians have a kind of shamanistic legacy. We are seen as working on the gateway to the other side, so to speak. We have closest relationship to death itself, and therefore are seen to have a certain kind of black magic as a potential to be used by demagogic forces, and that can be expected to continue. Now, when this survivor whom I quoted with those words, this world is not this world, when he said that, he was telling us also that one's moral universe had also been shattered by Auschwitz, by Nazi genocide, by an event of that dimension. And he had been cast into a terrible realm of evil, which will certainly haunt him forever, as is true of all survivors of Nazi genocide. To talk about genocide, we must talk about evil. And one must bring one's professional, in my case, psychological perspective along with a moral perspective and never forget the second or reduce it to the first. There are at least three different ways of looking at evil. One is to see it exclusively as a moral state, only to be judged and not probed from the standpoint of causation, just judged. And there were some people who urged me not to do my study, just stand back from evil and judge it and not go into any sort of probing. One can carry that idea further and see evil as a visitation from without, some dark, more than natural force, perhaps coming from Satan, which in its extreme manifestations can't be understood in human terms. Or there can be a third, primarily secular point of view, which is closer to my own, in which evil is a specifically human state. We don't think of cats and dogs as being evil. And it is influenced by certain psychological and historical forces. So we can probe those psychological and historical forces in order to see which kinds of forces are conducive to evil. So we study evil in that sense to uncover it, and there's a reason, a rationale for the study of evil from that standpoint. Yet the religious approaches to evil are not to be dismissed because they can convey something about the depth of depravity that's involved. Sometime after World War II, in the 1950s, a famous German playwright, Rolf Hochhut, a well-known anti-Nazi playwright, wrote a play called The Deputy, and it was a very realistic play which described the failure of the Catholic Church to speak out against the killing of the Jews and the effort on the part of one man to convey the truth of what was happening. Everybody in that play was portrayed very naturalistically, realistically, except for a Mengele figure who wasn't portrayed naturalistically at all and whom Hochhut described in his introduction as an uncanny visitant from another world, contrasting with anything that has been learned about human beings. Better to view him as a figure of Satan in a medieval morality play. Well, I didn't agree with that, and I went to see Hochhut during my study, and I said, well, you know very well that the difficulty is that Mengele was a human being. And he said, yes, of course I know that. I wanted to portray the depth of his evil. But, you know, the problem for us is that human beings, and even quite ordinary human beings, can all too readily become involved in evil. And Mengele, or any Nazi doctors, not just Mengele, is not totally removed from the rest of us. From this secular position, the assumption is that Satan is a human creation. And in that sense, we don't have the right to separate a corner of evil in the world and the rest of us, but rather to recognize a human potential for evil, which is universal. One survivor of the Holocaust, a very well-known figure who is a friend of mine, whom I went to see soon after I'd begun my work, he said, tell me, when you saw these Nazi doctors, and he had himself seen them in Auschwitz, were they men or were they demons? And I said, you know very well they were men. He said, yes, but it is demonic that they were not demonic. In other words, it would be a lot easier for us if they had the mark of Cain on their forehead, or if they were all psychotic, if they had been evil from the first day of their lives. But that wasn't the case at all. Most of them were neither better nor worse than others. They hadn't killed anybody before they got to Auschwitz. They got into a certain situation in which a number of forces in them and outside of them led to their doing what they did. And that's what... Now that brings us back to what was quoted in terms of Hannah Arendt's concept of the banality of evil. But I would modify that concept and say that the evil that these men perpetrated, as Arendt knew, was not banal. The men were banal. The evil they perpetrated was not. And when they perpetrated this evil over a considerable period of time, they were no longer banal. They themselves took on evil, as indeed happened over the course of these events. Now, what did Nazi doctors do? They were part of what I came to see as a biomedical vision. Hitler and Mein Kampf wrote that the Nordic race is the only culture-creating race. All other races can sustain culture when it's been created by the Nordic race, and the, quotes, Jewish race, of which there is no such thing, only destroys culture, is a culture-destroying race. Therefore, the Nordic race had been very strong, but it had been infected by the, quotes, Jewish race, and something must be done to remove this infection. That was the language he used. He didn't say we had to kill them all, but they had to be dealt with in order to bring about a cure for the Nordic race. In that sense, his whole vision was racist and biological. One of the Nazi doctors I interviewed told me, I joined the Nazi Party the day after I heard a speech by a leading Nazi figure in which he said National Socialism is nothing but applied biology. Hitler and other leaders saw the whole process as a biological one, getting rid of the Jewish race, thereby curing the Nordic race and creating something like a biocracy in the way that priests would be the leaders or rulers of a theocracy. A biocracy would be run in the name of biological principles. It's a very good example of the dangers of claiming a kind of scientific, in this case, a biological truth for a genocidal project. So the Nazi doctors became part of that biomedical vision, killing in the name of healing, in several steps. There was first coercive sterilization. That wasn't unique to Germany. It was done in the United States and England and all through Western Europe. But there was a leading Swiss German named Ernst Rudin, who, as one of his followers told me, was a more fanatical geneticist than a Nazi. Nonetheless, he became a Nazi because the Nazis offered him a chance to get rid of all the bad genes, he thought, that caused mental illness and other harmful conditions. And therefore, that kind of sterilization could be done in the name of some kind of idealistic projection. And of course, there were no restraints. They could, the practice could eventually be discontinued by law in democracies, not so in Nazi Germany. A second stage was the so-called euthanasia, or medicalized killing of children, so-called life unworthy of life, a concept that was actually created by a leading German psychiatrist and a jurist even before the Nazis. And one former Nazi doctor told me it was easier to kill very young children. He was involved on a ward and was involved actually in the killing. And he said they were given sedatives and it seemed like a putting to sleep more than an actual killing. A third dimension was the so-called euthanasia, or you have to have quotes around it. It's not really euthanasia, which has to do with helping the dying to die. This is the medicalized killing, or the medical killing, in the third stages of adults, in which project they created gas chambers and much of the mechanism and practices and indeed personnel for the concentration camps. And the head of that, at least the titular head, was a man named Karl Brandt, who was a very well-educated, kind of charming Nazi. I call these people, in quotations, you must have the quotation, but decent Nazis, with some kind of irony, because they were the ones who could sit next to at a dinner party, were very well-spoken. They saw their mission as getting rid of the thuggish element within the Nazi movement, but they were ardent Nazis, and they did most of the work of the Nazis because they were the most able among the professionals, and that was Karl Brandt. In any case, they carried through this so-called euthanasia on adults. It was the only program that was protested and ever discontinued in Nazi Germany because many families noticed that their family members who were mentally ill were being killed in this program and were disappearing. But even when it was discontinued officially, it continued unofficially, so it was never fully really stopped. Then there was another phase of bringing the so-called euthanasia program into the camps, and that would make an ordinary camp into a death camp because people could be sent from a camp to a killing center. And then finally, of course, there was Auschwitz itself and other death camps, the genocide carried through. doctors were involved in all of these stages, and the motto of the so-called euthanasia program was, the syringe belongs in the hand of the physician. But the syringe was a gas cock. The whole thing was medicalized and gave it a pseudo-medical therapeutic aura. In Auschwitz, doctors performed the selections at the ramp, which are well known and much reenacted in various places. And they also did, and in those selections, they were often very large scale, and thousands of Jews would arrive, the great majority of which, sometimes all of which, or up to 90% of which, never entered the camp. They were simply sent to the gas chambers without being admitted to the camp. Once Auschwitz became a death camp, it was only Jews who were selected. But they also did selections in the camp and in medical blocks to weed out those who were weakest in order to reinforce the slave labor contingent in the camp. Now, the chief camp doctor, Eduard Wirtz, was an idealistic physician. I write about him in my book. He was an idealistic physician who became an ardent Nazi, but he was a relatively decent man in those days who went out of his way to treat Jews when it wasn't quite legal to do that anymore. He was appalled by what he found in Auschwitz, but he was sent there because he had joined the SS and was an ardent Nazi, and it was thought he could help overcome, combat an epidemic of typhus in Auschwitz. He was horrified by what he saw there, but loyal to the Nazi movement and to the German military, whom he saw himself as serving. And after the war, he killed himself when taken into British custody. It may be partly out of guilt and partly out of a recognition that he had no future, because he would have been tried and put to death at Nuremberg or elsewhere. People like Wirtz had a conscience. It shouldn't be said that Nazi doctors or Nazis in general didn't have a conscience, but it was applied in the wrong place. It was applied toward loyalty to his comrades and to the Nazi movement rather than interposing it between himself and his victims, which is where a conscience belongs. And he's an example of how someone who had appeared to be a relatively decent doctor, in fact a very scrupulous one, could become a killer. I was able to interview his daughter, who was by then a middle-aged housewife, and I felt rather sympathetic toward her. She was struggling to understand how she had bounced on her father's knee, and she had loved him very much, and she discovered later on she was bouncing on his knee part of that time in Auschwitz. And at the end of our interview, she looked at me quizzically and said, Dr. Lifton, can you answer a question? I said, yes, what is it? She said, can a good man do bad things? And I thought about it for a while. I said, yes, I suppose so, but then he's no longer a good man. Nazi genocide, and the behavior of physicians in particular, was a mixture of idealism and terror. There was a Nazi projection of idealism. They told their doctors that you wouldn't be selfish one-on-one doctors, you would be doctors to the folk. You would be biological soldiers, you would be cultivators of the genes, you'd be contributing to the revitalization of your own people. On the other hand, they brutally destroyed all opposition and swept up all professionals through a pattern of what was called Leischaltung, which means re-gearing. And it really means not destroying professions, but destroying opponents and reconstituting the professions in a Nazi idiom. Now, how could Nazi doctors in an immediate psychological way do what they did? When I tried to answer that question, I came to a concept I call doubling, which I'll describe to you in brief terms. But it's a very important one, because what I believe happens in relationship to all genocide or mass killing is that the killers form what could be called a second self. They undergo a pattern of doubling. And doubling really means the formation of what is functionally a second self in an extreme environment, as happened in Auschwitz. So that Nazi doctors, for instance, in Auschwitz, would do all the things I mentioned, 6 days a week or whatever, and then they'd go from Poland back to Germany on leave for a long weekend or for 10 days or whatever, and be ordinary fathers and husbands. In Auschwitz, they would live from that Auschwitz self, whose norm was the killing functions they carried through, while they would be a father or a husband and live from the relatively more humane self which they had brought into Auschwitz. The doubling involves a certain degree of holism and autonomy. It's as if of course it's the same person, it's the same self, but the second self, the Auschwitz self, seems to be separate, to function as if it were a separate element from the prior self. And it has a more or less holistic function so that it not only enables one to adapt to the killing in Auschwitz, but also to the entire vulgar environment, the jokes, the heavy drinking, the entire style of existence in Auschwitz. It has a life-death dimension because perpetrators have to ward off death anxiety themselves, as they did. And of course, it has a function of avoiding guilt, because that second or Auschwitz self takes on the dirty work, so to speak, for which one then needn't consider one's prior self or one's overall self responsible. And it can happen at an unconscious dimension, as well as a desire to adapt to Auschwitz, which most Nazi doctors had. The reason why they wanted to adapt to Auschwitz is because even though many Nazi doctors were horrified and experienced a lot of anxiety and indeed had nightmares over those first days in Auschwitz, they didn't ask to be transferred because it was late in the war and they knew that if they were transferred, they'd be sent to the Eastern Front, where many Germans, including doctors, were being killed in very large numbers. So they adapted to Auschwitz. They had conflicts, but unfortunately they could overcome their conflicts sufficiently to carry out that murderous work. And part of the adaptation was a socialization process that saw them into the doubling, so to speak, in which more experienced Auschwitz doctors would go with them to their first selection, show how it was done, help them through it, explain to them that this is tough stuff, but we didn't create it, or maybe it's only temporary. Anyhow, we save a few lives by selecting them for the camp or to live in some way, and in that sense, help them to adapt to the overall process. Now, doubling is a form of what's called in psychological work splitting, separation of one portion of a self from the rest of the self. It's also what was called by Pierre Janet, who was an early contemporary of Freud's, a form of dissociation. But the term doubling is useful because it suggests that there was an overall holistic subself quite functional in that other environment. It helps us understand a lot of other situations. For instance, in terms of the famous Schindler, who has to be admired for what he did as a highly imperfect man, one could say that he stayed a Nazi. He went on drinking with his Nazi compatriots or comrades, even as his rescuer self got stronger and stronger. And finally, toward the end, it was the rescuer self that took hold more than the Nazi self. But that kind of doubling, in his case, doubling toward a constructive dimension, can help explain his behavior. Without going into the psychological detail, a lot of the basis for this can be found in the work of Otto Rank and William James, rather than that of Freud. Now, doubling in this case enabled Nazi doctors to adapt to their killing process, but doubling can be life-saving as well for a soldier in combat, for instance, or even for prisoners in Auschwitz who also experience an Auschwitz self which had to deal with much more brutal behavior, so that some Auschwitz survivors will say to you, I was a different person in Auschwitz, and one can virtually, literally understand that. And in doubling, there is a disavowal of what one does, so that for Nazi doctors, particularly if they were in some degree involved in the Nazi ideology, by and large, most Nazi doctors were not extreme ideologues. Mengele was an exception. They believed in the revitalizing promise of the ideology, which was very important. They could even laugh at some of its extremes. But they could disavow the part of the self that killed as doing the work of Auschwitz necessary to them in doing their job, so that what they experienced was not killing. So they knew what they were doing, but didn't take on the meaning of killing or the meaning of that reality. And that's what disavowal really means. In that sense, doubling is an adaptation to extremity, and it's an adaptation to evil, or it's a form by which, it's a pattern by which one can adapt to evil. Now, doubling also is undergone by lots of other people, other groups such as mafia members in American culture who might order the killing of many people and still be pillars of the community and give money to churches or community groups and really see themselves as pillars of the community. Or members of delinquent gangs can undergo doubling, or right-wing torturers or various kinds of terrorists can undergo a form of doubling that has parallels to what I've described. One can say that doubling is the psychological means by which one calls forth the evil potential of the self, and that that evil is neither inherent in the self nor foreign to it. In other words, the point of view I'm taking is that we all have a potential for good and evil, and in various ways the potential for evil can be brought out. And however we explain the way in which that potential is brought out, we're still culpable, we're responsible for our evil. I've explained some of the process of doubling, but Nazi doctors remain completely responsible for what they did. Doubling helped enable them to do what they did, and their responsibility is sustained, at least in my way of looking at it. Now, it wasn't just doubling that enabled them to do what they did, it was the mechanism through which they could do what they did, but also there was the healing, killing paradox in Auschwitz. You had to kill people in order to allow some to survive in that selections process. And there was the extreme psychic numbing, as I call it, diminished capacity or inclination to feel, which Nazi doctors underwent, all the more since Auschwitz was such an extreme place, like a distant planet is the way that Nazi doctors described it. And in that sense, what happened there, in a sense, didn't count. Also, the ideological fragments, that ideology of revitalization, that was enough to help them through this socialization to Auschwitz. And there was a kind of professional identity they sustained. Some of the reasons why Nazi doctors performed grotesque experiments in camps was because they wanted to keep their hand in as scientists rather than being only involved in killing functions. So they maintained a kind of fraudulent but psychologically significant sense of professional identity, even as they were killing people primarily. Nazi doctors, as with all of us, required a sense of meaning in regard to what they did, and this is a strange kind of finding. We are such creatures of meaning that Nazi doctors could go to their work every morning, they would tease their secretaries or assistants, they would make backbiting comments about their bureaucratic rivals, just as though they were part of an ordinary life-enhancing organization rather than at the center of a killing machine. A lot of the process had to do with the partial commitment to the ideology and the various kinds of socialization that I've been describing. In that sense, one can be socialized to evil and be a rather ordinary person who is socialized to evil if the genocidal institution has a strong position in one's society. One could say there are certain institutions like Auschwitz which are atrocity-producing institutions, and they run on doubling. Auschwitz is unimaginable except for the doubling that its leading protagonists or its leading participants underwent. One can ask, did Nazis have to double? They were Nazis after all, and Nazis are cruel, but I found that the arrival in Auschwitz was a dimension of evil that was shocking even to cruel Nazis, and they had to undergo some kind of socialization of the kind I described. One can also raise the question of whether doctors as a profession are more prone to double than others. Any of you in the audience who are physicians can remember how the very first day of medical school they thrust a corpse in front of you and they say, now go dissect it. That's supposed to be the first day of gross anatomy, but it's also a ritual that tells you you're now moving into the shamanistic world and you're moving into the world of death and you've got to not flinch before death, so that doctors are encouraged to undergo considerable numbing and perhaps doubling as part of our profession. And there have been certain studies that show that many doctors go into their profession out of, or partly out of, their own struggles to cope with the fear of death. So it could be that doctors or others in so-called forbidden zones of death-related professions are more prone to doubling than others. But if that's so, then it's, you know, only a degree, and doctors merely show as a profession what everybody else can be capable of, but perhaps doctors a little more so. Is doubling a German cultural tendency? Because, you know, we hear much about the doppelganger or various doubling patterns in German culture, and Otto Rank, who wrote about this, drew many of examples from German romantic literature, and Nietzsche writes about the torn condition, Zerrissenheit, of the German soul, as have many others. And of course, the Faust legend and Goethe's treatment of Faust, the famous classic of Faust, in which Faust says, in Goethe's words, two souls, alas, reside within my breast, and each withdraws from and repels its brother. That's a perfect poetic and clinical description of doubling. But when one looks into the matter further, one finds that the first poet to take up the Faust theme was Christopher Marlowe, the British poet, and that there is doubling. There are novels and literature of doubling in all cultures. It would seem to be a universal proclivity which the Germans seized upon and which has strong expression in German culture. Now, there is a great moral paradox here, because doubling is part of the human repertoire for adaptation. That's our genius as human beings. That's why we've done so well so far in the evolutionary scheme of things, because we're marvelous at adaptation. But the moral paradox here is that this very adaptive process, if very successful in genocidal institutions and genocidal environments, can do us all in and end the evolutionary process. In other words, we use our adaptive skills for doubling as an adaptation to genocide, and genocide, of course, could end everything. Now, in my recent writings, and I spoke about this in an earlier talk, I'll just refer to it partially here, I've gone back to a concern about the resilience of the individual self. In having given you this message, we see all too much resilience in adapting to evil. But that same resilience also enables us to survive trauma and evil, learn from it, and illuminate that which we have survived. In that sense, I've developed a concept that I call the protean self. And the protean self, protean means many-sided. It's in all of us now. It has to do with our time historically. And it means a certain dimension of flexibility and many-sidedness and fluidity, which is a modus vivendi, which we require in our very protean world. And there is a kind of proteanism writ large at a macro level in the many changes that our world has undergone, including some great moments in the late 80s and early 90s of revolutions for freedom in Eastern and Central Europe, and the breakdown of the Soviet Union. All sorts of dubious things have happened since then, but we shouldn't forget these moments of what I would call protean transformation at a collective level and at an individual level. And what's of enormous hopefulness about the protean capacity that we have is that the protean self can become a species self. That is, we can take on, as we have at our better moments, a sense of self in a nitty-gritty way that is built from, importantly, a recognition that we are part of humankind. In that sense, we can still be an American or a Christian or a Jew or a Hindu or whatever. We can be a teacher, we can be a working person, we can be an athlete. But all of these sub-identities are subsumed to a part of a sense we have of being a human being. At our better moments, we have that, and this requires a sense of empathy. But the very genocidal process in our world, still so menacing to us, presses us toward species consciousness, species mentality, and species self. Once we recognize that our technological instruments can annihilate virtually every person on Earth, we experience what I call shared fate. We have a sense of kinship with every other self on the planet, because we recognize that we may all go down together if we don't pull together to survive. And that shared fate can be the beginning of a species mentality and species consciousness, and then there are various religious and secular leaders whom we can turn to who have articulated these ideas and are still in the process of articulating them. I can remember on a trip to the Soviet Union, which I made when it was still the middle of the Cold War as part of a delegation of Americans, worldwide physicians, anti-nuclear movement, and there was a lot of things that weren't all that pleasant in our experience, but there was one moment that was unforgettable, and it was recorded on film, and we could see it again on film, in which we were at a large cardiovascular center, and it happens at the head of both delegations were cardiologists. It may be that cardiologists really have hearts. In any case, they examined in turn a very sick, elderly Russian man who clearly had advanced heart disease, and it was fascinating to watch them because at that moment, Russianness and Americanness disappeared. Even the whole mission of anti-nuclear protest, which we shared, that disappeared. These were simply two healers deeply concerned about a very sick fellow human being whom they might just be able to help survive if they put their efforts together. It's what I call a species mentality, and I've never forgotten that particular scene. Let me close by returning to the principle of witness with which I began these remarks. During a Holocaust Memorial Week, during our studies of the Holocaust, during our observations and our commitments that we make as citizens in connection with the Holocaust and genocide more generally, our task is to strengthen our commitment to combating mass killing and to reduce human suffering, and in that way, to contribute to life-enhancing alternatives. I'm going to close with some lines of poetry because these express what I'm trying to say much more eloquently than I can. The first is by an Israeli poet, T. Carmi, who writes, "What happened really happened. What happened really happened. What happened really happened. I believe with perfect faith that I will have the strength to believe that what happened really happened." And then finally, the American poet Philip Levine, "Let me begin again as a speck of dust caught in the night winds, sweeping out to sea, a tiny wise child who this time will love his life because it is like no other." Thank you very much.